weather for you, right? It was really nice, and then it gets cold. Is it going to get cold again? Do you know?
It's going to rain.
It's going to rain. It's going to be freezing rain. Yeah. Good. Then it won't be too cold. All right. Well, guys, let me, once again, I'm glad to have Austin and Heather Johnson visiting us. Some alums back brought some of their students from the youth group to come and visit with us. Welcome. We're glad you guys are here. To where I won't make you stand up or anything. That's all the embarrassment that we'll have. But, man, here we are, right? This is our last Thursday night of the semester in this room. And if everything goes well, maybe next year this room will be a little bit bigger. It'll look a little bit different. So we're hopeful. We're hopeful that maybe we can add on to this, and we'll see how that goes. We've got a few more steps to go through, all right? So next week, we're not going to be here. We're going to be at Laura Street Baptist Church at 7 o'clock. And the reason we're doing that is we always end the school year with a senior testimony night, and I give our seniors an opportunity to share what God has done, share what kind of some parting words and maybe a challenge that they have for those of you who are not leaving. And then we just want to hear what they're up to. And we're going to, after that, we're going to get them all in a nice clump, and we're going to pray for them. We'll pray over the clump of seniors. And then the last thing that we always do is we will have Bibles that is a gift to them from the BSU, and you guys will write in them like a yearbook. You'll write in the front, write in the back, write in the margins. Some of you guys even open to a specific page in the Bible or a verse, and you write there, and they find it like 10 years from now. So what a gift, all right? That's exciting, all right? So we're doing that next week. And the reason we're not doing it here is so that you can invite your friends, so you can invite your family, so you can invite supporting church members. Anybody that you think would want to come, that's close enough to come, invite them, okay? All right. Yes?
Yeah.
It's almost the end of the semester, isn't it? You feeling it? Yeah. I understand. It was a beautiful day today. It's nice when it's so warm in here because it was so nice outside. So I'm thankful for that. Okay, that's a little something. It's nice enough outside that I feel like it's time to start playing slow pitch softball again. So that's good. All right, well, hey guys, let me bring you up to speed on where we've been for the past several Thursday nights. We are wrapping up our semester with Images of Salvation. And we began with propitiation. Now, these big words, we've got propitiation and justification and redemption and reconciliation. These are kind of, you know, those big 50-cent Bible words, but they're really important words. Because if we don't understand these words, then we don't understand all that God has done for us. And it makes it really hard to read the scriptures and actually get it. So the first week we looked at propitiation and how that really took us to the temple, outside the temple where the sacrifices were made, and that God is angry with sin. That God's wrath is his holy response to evil. And so that we're under the wrath of God, and so there had to be a propitiation, there had to be a sacrifice made to take away God's wrath. And so that's what propitiation is all about. And then Mark shared with us about justification, and that takes us into a courtroom. And that through Christ we're declared not guilty, okay? Not guilty, that we have the righteousness of Christ credited to us. And then last week we looked at redemption, and this idea that to be redeemed is to be bought out of a desperate state, and that we were bought out of our bondage to sin. And that gives us kind of the picture of a marketplace. And so tonight, we're going to look at this thing called reconciliation. And it's a word that I'm sure you've used before. Probably you don't use propitiation in your vocabulary day to day. Maybe you don't use justification that much. Redemption, I don't know. Maybe those words get used a little bit. I would say reconciliation is a word that we have the best understanding of. When you're... Do any of you guys reconcile your bank statements? How many of you guys look at your bank statement? Okay, there's a couple of hands. That's good. Do you know what it means to reconcile your bank statement?
Yeah, no.
What does it mean, Ann?
You basically approve the amount of something you've made and paid for.
Okay.
So
you're making sure it's all right. So you're comparing and you're making sure that these two things line up, that they're in agreement, that what the bank says is actually true. Okay, that's reconciling your bank account. You state an app, and you look at all your transactions, and then you see what's in the bank, and you make sure that all the math lines up, that they're in agreement. And so it's kind of maybe a weird, you don't think about it that way all the time, but that's what that's called. It's called reconciling your bank account, okay? Maybe we're more familiar with that in terms of a relationship. You know, that these people need to be reconciled. That there's something going on. Anytime there's reconciliation, right, we understand that this implies that there's something wrong in a relationship. Just like all the other words that, none of these words that we're looking at, propitiation, justification, redemption, and reconciliation, like none of these words are flattering for us. Okay, propitiation is necessary because God's wrath was on us. That's not good. Justification was necessary because we were guilty sinners. That's not good. Redemption was necessary because we were in bondage to sin. We were slaves to sin. And there was nothing we could do to set ourselves free. Like, that's not good. And reconciliation is that there is something wrong between us and God. This relationship is not how it ought to be. And so, last week, I shared with you guys, did anybody go watch Father the Bride 2? No. Right? Because there's not a VHS store anymore, a video store in town where you can actually go rent a movie. Right? All right. But it would have been okay if you had. Okay? It's a nice, safe, wonderful, clean movie. Okay? And it's funny. It's really funny. Right? And maybe Abby's going to watch it eventually. Okay? You've already seen it. Okay? But you can watch it again. Have all your friends seen it? They haven't. There's your next movie. Okay, it's done. All right, I want to see that happen. Okay, so sorry to share that with you guys, but when I think about reconciliation, and man, maybe even think of a movie where reconciliation happens, where these two people are at odds with one another. Who knows what it is? Maybe it was a romantic relationship that falls apart, and then by the end of the movie they come back together. Or maybe it's best friends that turn against one another and then they come back together. Maybe it's a family that falls apart. I don't know. But I'm sure you can think of something, right? Think of a movie where there's reconciliation. Think of a movie. You think of something. I'm not going to ask you what it is. Just think. Think of that. Yeah. It's been said that this is probably, of all the four pictures of salvation that we've looked at, that this one is the most personal. And this one resonates with us the most because we have experienced this. We understand what it is to be alienated, what it's like to be to feel unrest or feel like something's not right, or we have a relationship that has gone awry, and we know that, we experience that, and we don't like that. And so this word, more than any of the others, I think is something that we live with day to day. And I it wouldn't be that hard to pull out a movie and show you guys a movie clip or talk about a movie, explain some sort of a movie scene that illustrates reconciliation. But there are a lot of different verses of scripture I want to share with you guys tonight, and I'm going to start with a story in the Bible. And this is a story that some of you are probably familiar with, but this is one of my favorite visuals. I hope that when you read the scriptures, like you don't like take your brain and leave it over there. Like, I think you should engage your imagination. You should try to visualize, what did this look like? What did it smell like? What were the expressions on these people's faces? Like, you'll get more out of your reading of the scriptures if you do that. And this is a story that you just can't read and not. Maybe. I don't think you're going to read this story and not be impacted by the story. So I just want to just read this as a way of introduction to reconciliation before we get into any specific passage that I really want to share with you guys. But this is in Luke chapter 15. And you can turn there if you want, but you don't have to. I'm just going to read the story to you. In Luke chapter 15, starting in verse 11. And I'm going to read 11 to 24. So follow along with me here. Jesus continued, There was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, Father, give me my share of the estate. So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. I always think that's kind of like he was a college freshman. So he leaves, he doesn't even do his dad, right? So he goes and squanders all he has in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country,
who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything." Like, this is the bottom of the barrel, about as low as you can get. This guy was feeding pigs, and he was envious of pigs. Like, I doubt any of you guys who have a farming background have ever experienced that, where you're just like, oh yeah, that stuff that we saved, whatever the leftovers are, whatever slop you give to the pigs, and you're like, this is how bad it was. And so in verse 17, when he came to his senses, and remember, he told his dad off. He told his dad, "I don't want anything to do with you." And then he took his dad's money, and he went, and he blew it all. He's so broke that he's longing for pig food. He says, when he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired men have food to spare? And here I am starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired men.' So he got up and went to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him." And really, I'll just stop right there. That is what reconciliation looks like. Like, that is one of my favorite stories in the Bible, just imagining that, because of course this is an analogy about God. And the lost son is the rebellious sinner. We could go on and we could read about the older son. The older son is like the self-righteous sinner. He's alienated from the father because he's such a good person that he looks down on his little brother. But here we see this younger brother who's just a notorious sinner. He's made a mess of his life, and when he finally has an aha moment, he says, "I have sinned. It was me, but I'm going to cast myself on my father's mercy." That the father runs, which is so out of character in this day and age for a father to act like this. But he runs, he throws his arms around him, he kisses him, he throws a party. That's reconciliation. Okay? That's what we're going to talk about tonight. This idea of a relationship where two people are at odds with one another. Sorry, I should put that up there. Two people are at odds with one another. And that's the thing that is so unique and so fascinating to me about reconciliation, is that you can't reconcile with someone who doesn't want to reconcile. The reconciliation is an act on both parties. Because it's pretty clear from this story that the father was watching. He was waiting, because when the son was a long ways off, he ran to him. So he saw him. It's not like dad was inside and told the servants, "Hey, if that kid shows up, let me know." He wasn't even allowing someone else to keep watch because he so wanted to be reconciled to his son. So, and yet there was nothing that he could do until his son came to his senses. And so this picture of reconciliation, so this one image is going to be on all the slides, which is what I've done for the past three times and I've been able to share with you guys. And I didn't read the story about the woman who carved this statue. Or sculpted out. I don't know what it's actually made out of, but I know a woman made this statue, and it's called reconciliation. And I just think, look at it, it's an embrace. It's an embrace. And that's what the father and the son did. I'm like, man, if you don't get anything else, I hope that you will remember that. Like, that is such a powerful image of reconciliation. It's an embrace. It's this relationship that has been restored. It's awesome. All right, So the Google's definition of reconciliation is the restoration of friendly relations. Okay, the restoration of friendly relations. Kind of a little bit more twist on that, a little bit more of a Christian understanding of reconciliation. It's the restoration of the favor of God. The restoration of the favor of God. And one of the things that I'm really glad that this is where we're finishing. You know, that we didn't, and there is a progression to these things. We're understanding that none of these, whether it's justification or reconciliation or redemption, none of these things can happen apart from propitiation. So Jesus dying for us, Jesus dying in our place, Jesus satisfying the wrath of God is what makes all of these things possible. But he takes away our sin, he takes away the judgment that is against us, he takes away our bondage to our slavery to sin, to the old way of life, all those things that we looked at last week. But this is, I feel like in a way, this is the whole end goal of this. It's not just so we wouldn't be guilty anymore. It's not just so we wouldn't be sinners anymore. We wouldn't be held bondage to sin. But it's that we would be reconciled to God. It's all because of this relationship that God wants to draw us back to. It's this embrace. And I mean, can you? There's that song that's, you know, says, "I Can Only Imagine." And that's a fine song. But just starting with that, think to that thought, can you imagine? I mean, to be embraced by God. That's the story that Jesus is telling, for the Father to run to this rebellious child and embrace him. Man, that's often not the picture that I have of God. The picture I have of God is often a lot more distant, a lot more disappointed, a lot more like, "What did you do wrong this time, Jason?" Rather than he's running to welcome me, he's running to embrace me because he loves me. So this is the picture I want to leave you with, guys. This is the point of all those other things, is that we might have this with our Heavenly Father. That this embrace of reconciliation would be ours, okay? And so reconciliation, again, it's something that I think that we understand because we've experienced alienation. And just as those other things had there was a problem that was presumed within the very definition of that word, the problem that's presumed in reconciliation is alienation, is to be separated in this relationship. And that's what these verses talk about. I'll turn it real quick. Ephesians chapter 2. And I referenced this a little bit last week, but I think sometimes, depending on how, if you're a follower of Christ, depending on what age that became a reality for you, when you recognized that you were a sinner who needed a Savior, when you recognized that you needed to be redeemed from your sin, all the things that we looked at, that sometimes, I don't know if this is exclusive or not, but I've experienced plenty of this, that the people who experience that at a young age sometimes don't necessarily appreciate the full scope and magnitude of salvation, as opposed to somebody who comes to Christ in their 20s or 30s and 40s, and when they're very aware of all the bad things that they've done. You know, when you get saved and you're 10 years old, you're probably not leaving behind, you know, sex, drugs, and rock and roll. So it's kind of easy to feel like, I mean, I'm not that bad of a person. And then we end up being more like the older brother in that story. So sometimes it's refreshing to me in a way to read these things, because these are theological truths that are true about every person on the planet apart from Christ, whether you are a good sinner or a bad sinner. So here in Ephesians chapter 2, all right, verses 12 and 13, he's saying, "Remember, at that time you were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel, foreigners to the covenants of the promise, without hope, and without God in the world." I mean, could you make it a little more bleak? Okay? He says, this is what you are apart from Christ. You're separate from Christ, excluded, and he's talking to these Gentiles who were not Jews, so they weren't a part of the covenant community. They were excluded from citizenship in Israel. They're foreigners to the covenants of the promise, without hope, without God in the world. But now, in Christ Jesus, you who were once far away have been brought near through the blood of Christ. Through the propitiation, we've been brought near to God. In Colossians chapter 1, just flip over a couple pages. Colossians chapter 1, verses 21 and 22. It says, "Once you were alienated from God." There's that word. "Once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior. But now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death, to present you holy in his sight, without blemish, and free from accusation." You see how all these words that we're talking about, they're all kind of tying together, because here he's talking about being reconciled, and he's talking about being made holy in his sight, that we were enemies, we needed propitiation. So we're seeing this reality that reconciliation implies alienation. Of course, that began in the garden, that Adam sinned, and we've been adding to it ever since. And so we can't really blame him for it, because we more than willingly add and do our own part in that. So reconciliation, it understands and implies alienation. Okay? So we're going to land here for a little bit. There's really kind of two passages. We're going to land here. We're going to start in Romans chapter 5. And then we're going to talk a little bit about reconciliation and just some of what that means. And tonight I have four things that I want to give to you. What is reconciliation? What does it mean? What difference does it make? What are the effects of reconciliation? Like, why is this such a big deal? Why should I be excited about reconciliation? So starting in Romans 5, I'm just going to read the first two verses, and I'm going to skip down to verse 6. And we're going to see some of the same words that we've been talking about for the past several weeks. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. And we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. So jumping on down to verse 6, he says, you see, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous man, though for a good man someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? For if when we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? Not only is this so, but we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. And these words, they're just all popping up all over the place. We have justification. We have it's propitiation, right? God's wrath being taken away because Jesus died to appease God's wrath and died in our place. And so these words continually intersect one another. And so that's why I think this is important. That's one reason. It's not the only reason. But, you know, I don't want you guys to understand propitiation so that that one time, you know, when you sit down with somebody and play Bible trivia, you get the answer right. Okay? That's not it. It's also not so you can start spicing up your conversation with big theological words and your friends can go, oh, wow, man, Zach, he's so close to God. I don't even know what those words mean. Wow. Okay? That's not the point. That is not why we need to increase our biblical IQ. But it is, I think it's safe to say, we have an epidemic of biblical illiteracy where, and I'm not even talking about out there, okay? I'm just saying within the church, within people who would say, I believe in Jesus, I want to follow Christ, I believe that Jesus died for my sins, I've repented, I trusted in him, where we don't know what the Word of God says. Or maybe we understand that some of these words exist, but we don't know what they mean. And there's so much freedom. The gospel is so good that we need to understand it. And so if we don't understand what God has done, then we're not going to be able to live in the freedom and the obedience that he calls for us. Even last week, you know, you're not just free, right? Like, you're either a slave to sin or you're a slave to righteousness. There's no third option. My God. That's what the Word of God says. All right. So this justification that we experience, that we have restoration, that this relationship has come through Christ, and it is all through his blood. And I don't interact with these people, but I read these things, and I just can't understand it. But again, Why keep bringing this up? Because there are people, I don't know what level we can call them Christian people. They would call themselves Christian people who deny these things, who deny the atonement, that Jesus atoned for our sins. There are some people who would say that God, that if Jesus would die for our sins, that if God would allow that to happen to his son, that God is like a cosmic child abuser. Okay, and I don't know if I mentioned that before. I feel like you guys have probably heard me say that once or twice, okay? Because that's baloney. But that's becoming kind of this logical pushback against the gospel, not understanding the nature of God, the character of God, and the holiness of God, but the love of God. And that this isn't something that happened to Christ, but this was something that Christ was willingly obedient to the will of the Father to do this on our behalf. Because he loves the sheep, and he lays down his life because he is the good shepherd. And so these are glorious things for us to understand. And that all of this leads to reconciliation, which he says, we rejoice. We rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. Okay, so I'm going to give you four things. What does reconciliation mean? What difference does this make in our lives? And all of this, all the weeks that we've been here, these things should result in rejoicing. These things should result in praise unto God. And I don't know about you, there are a lot of things in my life that aren't particularly joyful. There's a lot of things that they don't really lead to rejoicing, okay? And it's not that hard in this world to get discouraged and to for your eyes to get focused on whatever this is right here. And it's so frustrating, it's discouraging, it's disappointing. We don't have answers for that. And it steals our joy. And so hopefully this will help restore some of that tonight. This ought to lead to our rejoicing, reconciliation. So what is this? What does reconciliation mean? Okay, four things. First of all, reconciliation means access. Okay, it means access. And I'll put all three of these up here. That we have access to God. And that might seem not that cool. I don't know. Isn't it crazy? That could be not that big of a deal to us to have access to God. The history of mankind is filled with so many attempts to get to God. I mean, there are people in the history of the world who burned their children alive because they thought there was a God who would be pleased with that. Crazy stuff. And all these things to get to God, to please the gods, however many of them there may be, and that we have access to the one true God through Christ. That is pretty cool. This really denotes our communion with God, especially through prayer. And that we can talk to God and we know that God hears us. And nobody else has that promise. Nobody else has the promise, but those who come through faith in Christ have that promise. That they know that God hears and answers their prayers. And so Hebrews 4:16 says, let us approach, talks about Hebrews 4:14 and 15, he's talking about our high priest and how Jesus understands, because Jesus was made flesh and blood. So he understands what we go through. So it says, so then let us approach God's throne with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. To receive mercy and find grace. That we don't have confidence, guys, in our righteousness. That's not what that's saying. I don't have confidence in the fact that I'm a good person. But this is confidence in Jesus. Confidence in our high priest, the one who hears, the one who understands. And the God who wants this kind of a relationship, right? Right here. This. That's huge. This kind of God, it's not this kind of God as if there's many different kinds of gods, but this reality about God changes my perception. It changes my actions. It changes whether or not is God my first resort? Is God my first one that I run to, or is it a last resort? Well, we tried everything else. I guess we'll just pray. Because if I think God is angry, if I think God is against me, then I'm going to try everything else first. But if I believe I have access to God. And so it goes on in Ephesians. In Ephesians 2, I already read to you guys about some of those verses where it talks about the alienation that the Gentiles had. They weren't even able to come near the physical presence of God, let alone know God. And in Ephesians 2:18, he says, for through Christ, both Jews and Gentiles, we both have access to the Father by one Spirit. We have access to God. Ephesians 3:12, in Christ, and through faith in him, we may approach God with freedom and confidence. And so I think it's worth pausing for a moment and just asking if that is that characteristic of your relationship with God? That you come before him freely, that you come before him regularly, you come before him boldly, confidently, because you've been reconciled. Because he wants you to come. Because that was the point of the whole thing. Reconciliation, it means we have access to God, and that is no small thing. That would be enough of a reason to just stop. You're like, okay, I'm done. We're finished early tonight. Okay? We have access to God. Man, far too often, that is neglected. We have access. Okay, so first of all, reconciliation means access. Second of all, reconciliation means adoption. And here's still in Romans, over in Romans 8. Picking up in verse 14. It says, those who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. For you did not receive a spirit that makes you a slave again to fear, but you received the spirit of adoption. And by him we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies in our spirit that we are God's children. Now if we are children, then we are heirs. Heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ, if indeed we share in his sufferings in order that we may also share in his glory. That by the Spirit we cry, Abba, Father, Abba. And this was the term, this was how Jesus referenced the Father. And Jesus had this incredible intimacy with the Father that no one else knew or understood. And I don't, you know, this is, I don't know that this is true, but I can just imagine. This just seems to me that it would, you know, when you're little and you say your first words, you know, mama, dada. I just wonder, and it would probably be that hard to Google it. Somebody can Google it right now, tell me later. But I just wonder if you were, you know, a little Hebrew child, if that'd be one of your first words, you know, Abba. Abba. You know, daddy. It's like such an intimate, trusting phrase. It's not just God is our Heavenly Father, but he's right, he's my Abba Father. That, wow, that isn't done because I'm a good person. That isn't done because I'm deserving. It's done all because of his grace. And this is the kind of love that he has. This is the kind of reconciliation that he brings me into his family. You know, that son at one point is like, I don't deserve to be called your son. And I don't deserve to be called God's son. But this is what it means to be reconciled. That we have been adopted. In Galatians chapter 4, he says much of the same thing. Let me flip over there. There's a couple of really cool things there. Let me get over there real quick. Galatians 4, 4 through 7. It says, when the time had fully come, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem, there's that word, to redeem those under law, that we might receive the full rights of sons. Because you are sons, God sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, the Spirit who calls out, Abba, Father. So you're no longer a slave, but a son. And since you are a son, God has also made you an heir. So you will receive an inheritance. Like you have all the full rights that you belong in the family. And you know, I'm certainly no Bible scholar. I'm not a Bible translator. But I know that some of your translations might even say that you're all sons and daughters of God. Maybe some kind of newer translations. But I think this is really cool that it's really saying you are all sons. If you are in Christ, you're a son. It doesn't matter if you're male or female. And he says that at the end of chapter 3. In chapter 3, verse 26, you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. For all of you who were baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, male nor female, for you are all one in Christ. You belong to Christ and you're Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. It's a lot of really cool Abraham stuff in there as well. But he's saying there's nothing, there's no hierarchy of Christian. There's not that, you know, the men are a little higher than the women. He lists off different areas that are, you know, there are people who were Jews who thought it was better to be a Jew than to be Greek. There were people who were men who thought it was better to be a man than to be a woman. Certainly there were people who were free that thought it was better to be a free man than to be a slave. And he says, there's no division. You're all sons. You're all sons. You all have this equal inheritance. You have equal access. You're all sons. It doesn't matter if you're male or female. You're all sons of God. You have this full rights and you have an inheritance. And then in 1 John 3:1. I guess I didn't get that one up there. 1 John 3:1, John says, he says, behold what manner of love the Father has lavished upon us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. It's like he has to pause. It's not that we just should be called children of God, but it's true. That this is what reconciliation means. It's not just, and maybe this is just me, I don't know. I don't know if you deal with this or not, but I just so often I feel like I don't know that God really loves me. I mean, if he does, he loves me because he has to. Because he's God, but he doesn't want to. You know, I've just so often in my life I've struggled with that idea that God kind of puts up with me and he tolerates me. But this idea, that's just not what the scripture says. That he loves me like a son, like any other son. Like there's not a hierarchy of, you know, here's all my sons, and like Jesse does, we'll bring all my sons out before Samuel and David. He's out in the field, who cares about him? You know, he's the runter, whatever, the little kid. And that's not the case with God, that he loves us all, and he loves us equally. And it's not a matter of, oh, yeah, you're the one that he just puts up with. You're the one that he tolerates. You're the one that he hopes doesn't come out at the family reunion. No, that is not true, and I'm just sharing that for myself, okay? And so, so we see that it means adoption, and adoption means being brought into a family. And the thing is, any one of you who are a believer, you're not the only one, okay? And so adoption, reconciliation means adoption. Reconciliation also means a new community. A new community that you're brought into the body of Christ. You're brought into a family of believers. And so I'm going to go back to Ephesians 2 again. I told you guys I had a lot of verses tonight. But I don't get to preach next week, so maybe I'll do two sermons in one. Okay. In Ephesians 2, and I already read this, I'll pick up here. Therefore, remember that formerly you who are Gentiles by birth and called uncircumcised by those who call themselves the circumcision, remember that at that time you were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel, and foreigners to the covenants of the promise, without hope, without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who were once far away have been brought near through the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made the two one and has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility, by abolishing in his flesh the law with its commandments and regulations. His purpose was to create in himself one new man out of the two, thus making peace. I'm going to pause there. What Paul is saying is there's always been this division. There's really only been two groups of people throughout the history of the world. There's been the Jews and everybody else. So you're the Jew or you're a Gentile. There's always been a strong divide. In fact, in the temple, there was literally a wall where if you were a Gentile, you could come no further. And so that's what he talks about, this wall, this dividing wall of hostility. He says, in Christ, all that's been taken away. And now there's not Jew and Gentile, but there's Christian. There's this new man that has been made. There's this new classification. It's this Christ follower. And now you're neither Jew nor Greek. You're neither Jew nor Gentile. You belong to Christ. You're a son of God. This is the new man, this new community. He created a new community, and this is one of the miracles. One of the greatest miracles that God did was reconciling these people who were so at odds. We see this reconciliation happen between their relationships. His purpose was to create in himself one new man out of the two, thus making peace. And in this one body, to reconcile both of them to God through the cross, by which he put to death their hostility. Okay, so we have this new body that we're a part of. Now, this is a passage of scripture that I was just, actually went through this in my Sunday school class last week. It was sometime in church anyway, Sunday. This passage was, I was reading through this, and it just really struck me because in Mark chapter 10, Jesus is talking to his disciples, and it is, because it's the rich young man, and he goes away sad because he has great wealth, and the disciples are like, well, who can be saved? And they say, Jesus, we left everything to follow you. And this is what Jesus said to them. He says, I tell you the truth. No one who has left home or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for me in the gospel will fail to receive 100 times as much in this life. Homes, brothers, sisters, mothers, children, and fields. And with them persecutions. And in the age to come, eternal life. That Jesus promised his followers, he says, you know, those of you who've left behind everything, you've left behind families, you'll receive mothers and brothers and sisters and fathers and children. And guys, I'm convinced the fulfillment of this is in the church. This is where we receive a new family. This is where we receive brothers and sisters and sons and daughters, mothers and fathers. And I think it's just epidemic. It's a detriment to the American church that we're so isolated in and we don't interact and we don't enjoy the true benefit of this is what God has given to us, this new community. But God's goal is to reconcile people, okay? And there's a second story that I want to share with you guys. This is the third point, right? I got one more. But this new community, there's a second story that I want to share, and it's short. It's only four verses, and the story's not short. But the passage I want to pull up is short. In Genesis 33, okay, we read at the beginning this great picture of reconciliation. This is another passage. Man, I just love this. I could probably just like tear up when I sit down when you're not here and read the story. And in Genesis 33, it's kind of the culmination of all of the things that have happened between Jacob and Esau. And Jacob and Esau are twin brothers, and they've been battling their whole lives, and Jacob is a little smarter and a little sneakier than his brother, and he keeps taking advantage of him. And he's tricked him out of his birthright, and he's tricked him out of a blessing. And so at one point, Esau is like, you know what? I'm going to kill you. As soon as dad is dead, you're next. And so Jacob flees. And he's gone for, 14 plus years. He's gone. And we come to a moment in Genesis 32 where Jacob wrestles with God, and Jacob has to come face to face with his past. And he has to confess, I'm a deceiver. That's who I am. That's what I've been. And that's when God gives him a new name. And I feel like in some sense, it kind of almost like it signifies kind of a conversion experience for Jacob. And after Jacob is made right with God, the very next thing he has to do is be right with his brother. And so, guys, reconciliation, it means access. It means adoption. It means a new community. But in that new community, God desires us to be reconciled to one another. That it's not just a vertical, there's a horizontal reconciliation. So I just want to read these four verses. And it's going to sound remarkably similar to what I already read, the story of the lost son. It says, and Jacob sent his family. He was very, very strategic and deliberate in how he tried to approach his brother. But anyway, I won't get into all that. Oh yeah, I will. That's right here. Okay. So Jacob looked up, and there was Esau coming with his 400 men. So, here comes your brother with an army. And great. This isn't going to go well. So he divided the children among Leah, Rachel, and the two maidservants. He put the maidservants and their children in front, Leah and her children next, and Rachel and Joseph in the rear. He himself went on ahead and bowed down to the ground seven times as he approached his brother. Tell me, you just heard this. But Esau ran to meet Jacob and embraced him. He threw his arms around his neck and kissed him, and they wept. Man, that's reconciliation. It's an embrace that their relationship was restored. This new community, that it starts with our relationship with God and extends into our human relationships, especially in the body of Christ. And that we're to love one another, we're to be for one another, we're to embrace one another. So this is what it means to be reconciled. This is pretty good. All right? So reconciliation, it means access, it means adoption, it means a new community. The last thing that I want to share with you guys, reconciliation, it means that we're ambassadors. We're ambassadors. And then, If Romans 8 is the best chapter in the Bible, then 2 Corinthians 5 is probably runner-up. Okay, so we're going to flip over to 2 Corinthians 5. And I'm not going to dig into all this. Just briefly. Pick up in verse 17. It says, if anyone is in Christ, he's a new creation. The old is gone, the new has come. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ. And he gave us the ministry of reconciliation. Okay? So this is really important. Because God reconciled us to himself, and we enjoy access with God. We enjoy being able to come before God. We lay our burdens at his feet. He loves us as sons. But it's not just for us. There is a mission that comes with us. And so God has reconciled us, and he has given us the ministry of reconciliation. And that is true for every one of us. It doesn't mean that we all have to do it exactly the way the Apostle Paul did it. We're not all evangelists. We're not all going to go preach in the synagogue and then go find a wherever the next gathering place is and preach there in the marketplace. But we all are a part of this ministry of reconciliation. That God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting men's sins against them. And he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. This, guys, this is the message of the church. This is what we preach, okay? This is really important that we understand. We don't preach that Jesus can make your life better. We don't preach that Jesus will make you happy, that Jesus is the source of true joy, that Jesus is where you'll find fulfillment, even though that's true. That's not our message. Our message is about reconciliation. That every person on the planet is born as an enemy of God. That every person on the planet is born in a relationship with God that has been broken and severed and is not the way that it ought to be. But God desires reconciliation. And so he reconciled us, and he has given us this ministry. He has committed to us the message of reconciliation. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. Right? An ambassador is somebody who one country or a kingdom, they appoint like a diplomat, they appoint a representative, and they go to another country to represent that country, to be a messenger of that country, to share about that country. And that's what God is saying, that when we become a part of his kingdom, we become ambassadors. Wherever we go, we are representing him. We are sharing about him. We're giving the message of reconciliation. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. That verse, that's my favorite verse in the Bible, 2 Corinthians 5:21. I got a couple of guys. James Denny, who was a Scottish theologian who passed away almost exactly 100 years ago. And he's talking about this idea that Christ, the sinless one, Christ, the creator of all things, that he would take on our sin. He said, mysterious and awful as this thought is, it is the key of the whole of the New Testament. This is the key to the whole thing, is this substitutionary atonement on our behalf. Another guy, Emil Brunner, who was a Swiss theologian. He died about 50 years ago. Okay? He said, justification means this miracle, that Christ takes our place and we take his. I've also heard it said, you know, that Jesus was treated the way that we deserved, so that we can be treated the way that he deserves. This is the heart of our message. This is what we proclaim, that God is the author of reconciliation, and all of the initiative is his. And all these things, whether it was propitiation or justification or redemption or reconciliation, every single one of these things finds its initiation, finds its desire, finds its fulfillment, finds its energy, its drive, its completion is all in him. That's why we proclaim him. And so here it says in verse 19 that God has refused to reckon our sins against us. But he cannot condone them. He cannot dismiss them. And so Christ bore them personally in our place. And so here's the thing. We are ministers of reconciliation because God has done everything that is necessary for reconciliation on his end. From God's perspective, there's nothing left for him to do. Everything has been done. But it is still necessary for sinners to repent and turn to Christ in faith. That is our response. That is our message. Just as the father in the very opening story of the lost son, he could long for his son to return. But reconciliation requires that the son come back of his own accord, that the son return to his father. And so this is the message that we have. This is what we preach. And guys, it's pretty cool that when we share that message, when we preach the message of reconciliation, I hope that you understand what it means to be reconciled. The relationship is broken that started with Adam and continues in us, but that God desires reconciliation. That when we proclaim that message, that God works through us. That God speaks through us. That's what Paul says. It's as though God were making his appeal through us. And he says, we implore you. We beg you to be reconciled to God. And so as I kind of close these things down, and guys, as we've been looking at these four pictures of salvation, certainly the number one thing to ask and to consider is, have you been reconciled to God? It's intriguing to me that Paul is writing this letter to a church. He writes a letter to the church at Corinth, and he says to them, I know that this is a gathering of Christian people, but I'm telling you, be reconciled to God. He says, I'm confident that there are some among you that have never been reconciled to God. And that God has done everything that is necessary. But you have to receive that. You have to repent. You can't be the lost son outliving your own way. You have to come to your senses and turn back to the Father. And this semester, this is going to be the last time for me to beg you, to implore you to do that. To be reconciled to God. This is the link that God went to. That he who had no sin, Jesus Christ the sinless one, took your sin on himself. That you might become the righteousness of God. That he would be treated the way you deserve. So that you could be treated the way he deserved. what he deserves. He is the Son of God, and that we might be received as sons. And so, first and foremost, that is the number one application about this. But then after that, I just ask you guys, what do you do with that? Where are you going to go with that reality of reconciliation, whether it's praise, whether it's maybe it's a returning to God, maybe it's a kind of a tweaking your view of God and battling against that lie that God is angry, that God is disappointed, that you're just kind of a so-so child of God. I don't know. But I pray that you would do business with him, and above all those other things, guys, that you would be a minister of reconciliation. But this is the message. That's it. We don't have to spice it up. We don't have to make it better. You want to sugarcoat it? Just share the message of reconciliation. God speaks, God draws, God moves. That's what we share with people, that the Word of God is clear, that everyone is separate from God. God desires for us to be reconciled, and he's made a way. But you have to turn. You have to repent. You have to trust in Christ. And that's it. If I could push the believe button for somebody else, I would have already pushed it. Okay? We share the message. That's my challenge to you tonight. Share the message. So whatever else there may be that you need to do business with God, the worship team is going to come up and lead us in a closing song tonight. And I hope these four images of salvation have encouraged you, have helped you to better understand a little bit more what God has done for you in Christ. And if nothing else, it should result in praise. And so we'll close with that. We pray for you. Father, you're so good. I thank you. God, I want to be more and more. I want to be transformed. I want to be just overwhelmed by your grace and mercy and love in my life, God. I know all, I think it's all too well, how much I fall short, how just sin seems to have infiltrated every cell in my body. And that you would redeem me, that you would justify me, that you would take your wrath away through Christ's atonement, and that you would adopt me, that you would reconcile this relationship, God. I just don't. It's bigger than I get. I want to understand it more. Lord, I pray for my brothers and sisters the same, that we would be transformed by this reality, that it really would be Christ's love that compels us. And I don't think that's where I'm at, God. I want that to change. So thank you, Lord. You're good, and we love you. We lift these things up in your name. Amen.